In our last video on acids and bases, we concluded by discussing how to calculate pH and pOH. Let's continue our study. One of the last concepts within this chapter is titrations and finding an unknown concentration. In a titration, you will have a known concentration of base, usually. It's a stock solution, and an unknown concentration of acid. It can also go the other way around. You end up using a set number of grams or milliliters of acid, and you mix it with water, and you use a burette to measure the volume of the base used. It looks something like this picture up here. We'll be doing it in lab at a later date. Then we add an indicator to our solution so that it'll change color based on whatever pH we're looking for. For us, ours will end up turning a very light pink, and this pink color indicates the equivalence point where the H plus concentration equals the OH minus concentration. One more drop of base into the acid would result in a much darker pink, more similar to the picture you see here. And this is the endpoint, where the OH concentration is now slightly greater than the H+. We will focus on this in greater detail in lab. For now, you only have to know how to do the calculations, which we will again apply in the lab. So the equation here should look very familiar to you. Okay, MAVA equals MBVB. It's pretty much the same thing as M1V1 equals M2V2. So if you have a 1-to-1 ratio of H to OH, meaning your acid has 1H and your base has 1OH, or 2 and 2, or 3 and 3, you can use this equation. If you do not have a 1-to-1 ratio, which will happen, instead, you would have to use solution stoichiometry. Both of these equations are reviewed from our solutions unit, but we'll talk about them again to refresh your memory. Let's do the first one together. It says, if it takes 45 milliliters of a 1.0 molar NaOH solution to neutralize 57 milliliters HCl, what is the concentration of HCl? So we notice we have 1OH and 1H, so we can use M1V1 because it's a 1-to-1 ratio. Remember that the word of indicates that they stay together, so we're going to have our M1V1 equals M2, which I don't know, times V2. And then I just solve. When I solve this problem, I should get 0.79 molar. Okay. So that was an example of a 1-to-1. Here, what you guys are going to do is you're going to practice one that is 1-to-1 and one that is not. I'm going to help you slightly with the equation for the one that's not 1-to-1. So H2SO4 plus AlOH3 produces a salt and water. The salt is going to be Al2SO43 and then water. So what you'll need to do for this one is you'll need to balance it first, okay, and then do solution stoichiometry. Please refer to your solution notes if you need a refresher on that. At this time, pause the video and try both of these problems. Please check your answers. The first one here with HCl and NaOH is, again, 1-to-1, because there's 1H for every 1OH. So I just used M1V1. I used the word of to help me remember which goes on which side. And I solved algebraically. For the next one, you would notice that H2 and OH3 are not the same. They are not 1-to-1. Since they're not 1-to-1, you have to do stoichiometry. So you are asked to first balance the chemical equation, as I have done for you. and then complete the problem. For solution stoichiometry, we always take the volume of the given over 1 times the molarity of the given over 1. Then we do our balanced equation step, and then we take 1 over whatever the other number is, and you should end up getting 1.5 molar. Once again, if you need assistance with this, we covered it in great detail in our solutions unit. But it is fair game for this as well. The last part of our study on acids and bases includes buffers. Okay. This is something that if you've taken some biology classes or anatomy classes, you may have heard about before. A buffer is defined as a solution that resists change in pH. When a small amount of an acid or a base are added, a buffer is going to contain an acidic part and a basic part. So it can be a weak acid and its salt. So here's your acid part. Its salt would serve as the base. Or it can be a weak base and its salt. So that's the base. And then its salt would serve as the acid. So here you have an example buffer system, HF, a weak acid plus its salt. And the salt is basic. Okay. So let's kind of very, very briefly discuss what takes place. The acid component of the buffer is going to be the part that reacts with any added base to kind of counter it. And then the salt, which is basic, is going to react with any added acid to kind of counter it. Okay, that's really all you need to know for buffers, the definition, and that's very brief information there. Finally, many chemical reactions in our bodies must take place in a controlled pH environment. And then I have provided an example. Your blood typically has a pH of 7.40. Deviations of only about 0.2 can cause coma or become fatal. And therefore, part of this is why you have a buffering system. You're going to have a buffering system within your blood to kind of help with this and to help keep the pH at a constant level. Okay? Buffers do not necessarily neutralize things because you can have a buffer with a pH of 1. You can have a buffer with a pH of 14. Okay? Buffers resist change in pH and keep the pH constant at whatever it currently is. That's really important and a common misconception. That concludes our study of acids and bases.